In this video, we'll discuss about bilateral sagittal split osteotomy. This is the most widely performed orthognathic surgery on the mandible given by Abwegesser. Okay? And as the name suggests, it is bilaterally done on the mandible and there is sagittal splitting of the mandible. That means one fragment contains buccal cortical plate and another fragment contains lingual cortical plate. It is sagittally split. Okay, then coming to the indications, BSSY is indicated in cases of horizontal mandibular excess, that is true skeletal class 3. In that case, we are going to do the mandibular set down. If this horizontal mandibular excess combines with the midface deficiency, then we are going to plan BSSO along with the LIF-41 osteotomy with advancement. Then second indication is horizontal mandibular deficiency, that is in class 2 patients. In class 2 patients, we are going to do BSSO with mandibular advancement and maxillary LIF-41 osteotomy with mandibular maxillary setback. Then the third indication is mandibular asymmetries, and we can do BSSY in open bite cases. In those cases, we are going to rotate the mandible anti-clockwise, and we can do BSSY in deep bite cases also. In those cases, we are going to rotate the mandible clockwise. Then we can do BSSO for obstructive sleep apnea patients also. In those cases, by doing mandibular advancement, we are going to increase the nasopharyngeal airway space. Coming to the surgical technique, BSSO is generally done in general anesthesia and some amount of local anesthesia is infiltrated at the incision site. So incision is made just lateral to the external oblique ridge. The superior extent is midway between the maxillary molars and mandibular molars. You can see in this diagram, in between maxillary and mandibular molars, it is just midway in between superior extent. Then the inferior extent is within the buccal vestibule, approximately in between the first and second molar. When you are giving this incision, you have to retract the tissues laterally. After the incision, the next step is mucoperiosteal dissection. Start the mucoperiosteal dissection buccally. You always stay subperiosteally. After buccal flap retraction, then go superior extraction, that is along the anterior border of the ramus. Place a notched ramus retractor after retraction superiorly. After that, you are going to do the medial mucoperiosteal dissection. Medially, again, you have to dissect above the lingual mandibular foramen and you have to always stay subperiosteally. After mucoperiosteal dissection on the medial side, you are going to place a channel retractor which engages behind the posterior border of the mandible. By engaging the channel retractor, you are going to start the medial ramus osteotomy. Okay, so you are going to start the bone cuts. There are three bone cuts in BSSO, very much important regarding bone cut and their design. The first bone cut is medial ramus osteotomy, also called as a horizontal osteotomy. The second one is sagittal osteotomy. Third one is buccal vertical osteotomy. Okay, so before going for medial ramus osteotomy, you should identify two important structures. That is, first one is lingula and second one is sigma notch. Lingula is the bony prominence. You can see here bony prominence on the mandibular foramen, and it is approximately placed in a line extended posteriorly from the deepest part of the anterior border of ramus. You can see here, this is the anterior border of ramus and this is the deepest part of anterior border of ramus. It is situated in a line along with this. That is regarding lingula, and you have to identify the sigmoid notch also, this notch. So generally, your medial ramus osteotomy should be placed in between the sigmoid notch and the lingula. Okay, and it should be parallel to the occlusal plane. If you say this is the teeth, second molar, okay, so this is the occlusal plane. This medial ramus osteotomy and occlusal plane should be the parallel. They should be parallel. Start doing medial ramus osteotomy with a long fissured burr, generally called as Lindemann burr. Lindemann Burr. Or you can use normally, generally available 701 fissure burr also. That is SS White surgical burr. With that burr, you are going to place the medial ramus osteotomy. Always make sure you completely cut through the cortical bone. Once you cut through the cortical bone and on entering the medullary bone, you will feel a dip. That is the point where you have to stop your cut. And regarding this medial ramus osteotomy, originally as described by the obligator, it is to be extended till the posterior border of the ramus. Very much important. Originally, the medial ramus osteotomy is to be extended till the posterior border of ramus. That is all along the medial aspect of the ramus. But the problem with this technique is that we cannot access in every case, or there is difficult access to give the cut which extends to the posterior border. So Hunsack modified this medial ramus osteotomy to be extended till the just posterior to the lingula. This is the Hunsack modification of medial ramus osteotomy. It is to be extended just posterior to the lingula. There is no need to extend the till the posterior border of ramus. This is currently followed technique, and this is the older one, original one. This is Hunsack modification. Okay, so this is regarding medial ramus osteotomy. Once you completed medial ramus osteotomy, then you have to do the sagittal osteotomy. Sagittal osteotomy, that means you can see in this diagram. Okay, so from the medial ramus osteotomy, the cut is extended inferiorly adjacent to the buccal cortex, and the inferior end is in between the second and first molar. Okay, this is sagittal cut. The name derives also from this sagittal cut. So when you are cutting the sagittal osteotomy, make sure you cut through the cortical bone. There should not be any interference in cutting. There should be through and through cortical osteotomy, and you should not go deep into the medullary bone. If you do so, you are going to harm the inferior alveolar vessels and nerve also. Okay, if you not doing it correct way, the osteotomy design is not good, then you will feel problem at the time of splitting. Those will result in unfavorable fractures like that. So this is all about sagittal osteotomy. And the third osteotomy cut is the buccal vertical osteotomy. Okay, originally as described by the obligation, this buccal vertical osteotomy is essentially a oblique cut which is extended as which is directed backwards, aiming at the antagonial notch. You can see in this diagram there is variation in this buccal vertical osteotomy. Originally, it is directed backwards to the antagonial notch. But the problem with this design is, when you advance the mandible, there is little contact between the both segments. There is little contact between the proximal segment and distal segment. So what will happen? Due to the little contact, there may be the chances of non-union after the procedure. Bone segments fail to heal. To avoid that, there is Dalpont's modification. He modified this oblique cut into a buccal vertical cut in between the first and second molar. This is currently recommended technique. Okay, in this technique we are going to do, first we have to cut the lower border of the mandible, then we are going to extend it superiorly to connect with the sagittal osteotomy. We are connecting this buccal vertical cut to the sagittal osteotomy in between the first and second molar. This is Dalpont's modification. You have to remember and you have to understand these three type of osteotomies. If you understood this, BSSY is over. Okay, so first one is medial ramus osteotomy, done on the medial side of the ramus. Originally, it should be extended till the posterior border, but Hunsack modified it to extend just posterior to the lingula. And the second is sagittal osteotomy, This is the sagittal osteotomy. It is originally same. There is no modifications. And the third one is buccal vertical osteotomy. It is originally directed backwards obliquely to antigonial notch, but modified by dog punt to extend it as a vertical line in between the first and second molar. So regarding BSSO modifications, first one is Hunsack modification and the second one is Dahlpont's modification, that is Hunsack modified medial ramus osteotomy, Dahlpont's modified buccal vertical osteotomy, and there is fourth one, third one, Wohlfors osteotomy modification. In this modification, what we are doing, when you are cutting lower border of the mandible, that cut should extend, that cut should include both labial cortical plate and lingual cortical plate also. You can see in this, this red colored one is the osteotomic cut. So in this osteotomic cut, at the lower border, you should include labial cortical plate and lingual cortical plate also to avoid any unfavorable fractures when you are splitting the mandible. This is Wohlfors modification. And another modification called as Epker's modification. Epker. In this modification, he says that there should be minimal periosteal stripping and minimal muscle stripping when you are doing the, or when you are dissecting the mycoperiosteum. Because once you do excessive dissection or excessive periosteal stripping, the blood supply to the segments will be compromised and they may result in necrosis or non-union. So this is the Epker's modification. So there are main four modifications: Hunsack modification, Dahlpont modification, Wohlfors modification, and Epker's modification. Okay, this is all about your osteotomic cuts. One special consideration is presence of mandibular third molar. Ideally, this third molar should be extracted 6 months before the surgery. If it is present at the time of surgery, it must be considered as bone. That means due to the presence of third molar, you should not change the osteotomy design. You cut through the crown of the third molar and remove the third molar. Okay, it should not be changed any osteotomic cut. Once you finish the procedure on one side, the next step is to repeat the exact procedure on the opposite side. Okay, after that you are going to define the osteotomic cuts with the osteotome. After defining, you are going to split the mandible. The splitting the mandible starts with tapping on a osteotome which is placed in the sagittal osteotomy. You can see in this diagram. In the sagittal osteotomy, you are going to place a osteotome and you are going to tap it. In that way, you are going to split the mandible. You can use Smith's bone spreader. Smith bone spreader. This is specialized instrument used to split the mandible in BSSO. You can use that also. After splitting, you are going to mobilize the bone fragments. So after splitting, the fragment which contains the mandibular condyle is proximal fragment. That means this fragment is proximal fragment, and the fragment which contains the tooth, that is dental bearing region, is called as distal fragment. Okay, and after you are splitting and mobilization, you must ensure and identify the inferior alveolar nerve, because it should be attached to the distal tooth bearing segments, not on the proximal segment. If it is still attached on the proximal segment after splitting, then you have to detach it from the proximal segment. Okay, that must be considered. And after that, you are going to remove any muscular attachments on the distal tooth bearing segments, like a pterygomacetric sling or any masseter muscle fibers. Those must be resected from the distal tooth bearing segment, because this procedure makes the proximal segment and distal segments to move independently. There should not be any connections between proximal and distal segment. And you have to scrape the medial pterygoid muscles and stylomandibular ligaments present on the medial aspect of the angle also. If they are still attached, they result in relapse. Okay, so after doing mobilization and all these procedures, you are going to keep the teeth under intermaxillary fixation. You may use splint or you may not use splint, but keep the teeth under intermaxillary fixation. After that, you are going to do the fixation. Before fixation, the important, most important thing is condylar repositioning. That means when you are fixing the bone segments, the condyle must be exactly placed in the glenoid fossa. If it is not correctly placed, then after the postoperative period, it may result in the condylar sag or malocclusion. So the method to place the condylar within the glenoid fossa is, you can use a condylar positioning device. This is condylar positioning device. With the help of condylar positioning device, place posterior digital pressure on the condylar positioning device, and with the help of hand, place superior and anterior extraoral digital pressure like this at the mandibular angle. At the mandibular angle, with the hand, place superior and slightly anterior pressure at the mandibular angle. With these two types of pressure, due to the bone force transmission or due to the direction, the condyle will exactly sit in the glenoid fossa. That must be very much important procedure when you are doing BSSO. After confirming the exact position of the condylar fragment, you are going to fix the bone segments. So there are mainly two types of fixation in BSSO. You can use two lag screws or positional screws, and you can use bone plates also. Okay, in this diagram you can see that the lag screws are placed along the superior bar. Okay, these are the two lag screws. These two lag screws are bicortical. You can see in this diagram. They engages both labial cortex and lingual cortex also. You can use these lag screws or positional screws. This is one type of fixation in BSSO. Otherwise, you can use 2mm stainless steel or titanium mini plates, bone mini plates. Okay, if you are going to fix the mini plates, then you are going to place like this. This is the plate. Okay, so there must be two screws on one side and two screws on the other side. Usually one 2mm four hold with gap mini plate is sufficient. These are the two types of fixation, and you must confirm there is proper fixation, because if the fixation is inadequate, it will result in postoperative malocclusion. These are the two type of fixation. And when you are fixing the screws, it is not always possible to fix intraorally. That is why you may choose the method of transoral fixation with the help of trocar. That means you are going to place a small stab incision on the skin, on just above the lower border of the mandible. This is the lower border of the mandible. On just above the lower border of the mandible, you are going to place a stab incision through the skin and subcutaneous tissue. Then you are going to take a trocar and you are going to pierce from that skin incision. Okay, that trocar will appear intraorally through piercing periosteum. With the help of trocar, you can fix those screws from transoral method. That is one type of method, trocar. Okay, in detail explanation of trocar system is for PG students only. Okay, so these are the types of fixation available in BSSO. After fixation, you are going to release the IMF and check the occlusion. Occlusion must be accurate, like closing and opening movements, lateral translation movements. By those movements, you are going to check the occlusion. If it is accurate, then you are going to close the incision site. If it is not accurate, if there is a malocclusion, then you have to reattempt the fixation. You are going to remove the plates you have fixed, and you are going to reattempt it, refixing it. Okay? And after that, you are going to suture. Suturing must be two layered. Any muscles must be sutured first, then you are going to suture the oral mucosa. Then coming to the complications, the main complication is bleeding that may encounter from the injury of inferior alveolar vessels, if especially if your cut is gone deep into the medullary fossa. After that, nerve injury, inferior alveolar nerve injury, direct injury, or maybe it may be from the lateral traction or forceful traction of the flaps. Then condylar sag. Condylar sag is nothing but immediate or late change in the position of the condyle. In the position of the condyle within the glenoid fossa, that may result in the malocclusion. That means when you are fixing the bone segments, if the condyle is not in correct position in the glenoid fossa, then after the fixing or in during the postoperative period, it will change its path in the glenoid fossa, its position in the glenoid fossa. That will result in the malocclusion. And the complete, there is central condylar sac and peripheral condylar sac. The classification and management issues all for post-graduation level. Then the bad splits. Bad splits are nothing but unfavorable fractures. The main bad splits you may encounter is fracture of the buccal cortical plate of proximal segment and fracture of the lingual cortical plate just in front of the lingula. Bad splits nothing but unfavorable fractures. Okay, those occur because of improper osteotomic cuts. That means especially on the medial ramus osteotomy, we said that it must pass posterior to the lingula. If that cut is anterior to the lingula, then obviously this may result in bad split. Okay, and there is again classification and management of bad splits not considered here, and the malocclusion and the relapse. Okay, under relapse, the safe amount of mandibular advancement can be done through the BSSOE is 7 to 8 mm. If this amount is, the amount of advancement is beyond this limit, then obviously it will result in relapse. The same thing, the amount of mandibular setback can be done through the BSSOE is 7 mm. That is PG question. 7 mm is the safest amount by which we can advance the mandible or we can set back the mandible through BSSO. If this limit is crossed, then obviously it will result in relapse. And TMJ problems, obviously it will result in some 3MJ problems after BSSO procedure. So this is all about BSSO. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.